Assalamu alaikum. I'm Saba Bakai from Delhi. And my question to Ms. Zakir uncle is, the Christian concept of the God is a trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. But these three are one. Does this mean that they believe in only one God?
The sister asked the question that the Christians believe in Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and that they are one. Does it mean that they also believe in one God? Sister, if you analyze the word Trinity, it occurs nowhere in the Bible. If you search the full Bible, the word Trinity doesn't exist anywhere in the Bible. It's not there in the Bible. But the word Trinity is there in the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 171, it says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا سَلَاسَا. Don't say Trinity. إِنْتَوْ خَيْرُ لَكُمْ. This has stopped it, it's better for you. For God is one God. It's again repeated in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 73. It says, لَقَدْ قَفْرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ. They blaspheme those who say that Allah is one of three in a trinity. For there is no God but Allah. So the word trinity is not mentioned in the Bible, but it is there in the Quran. And Quran says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا سَلَاسَا. Don't say trinity. The closest verse that you can find in the Bible, which can be taken for Trinity, is the first epistle of John, chapter number 5, verse number 7, which says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. This verse of the Bible, first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse number 7, is the closest resemblance to Trinity in the full Bible. But if you read the Revised Standard Version, which has been revised by 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 different Christian cooperating denominations, they have removed this verse from the Bible as an interpolation, as a concoction, as a fabrication. It was not removed by Muslims or non-Christian scholars, but it was removed by 32 Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 different corporate denominations, as an interpolation, as a concoction, as a fabrication, because it was not there in the original manuscript. We Muslims, we should thank the galaxies of deities, the doctors of divinity, for getting the Bible one step closer to the Quran, closer to Islam. As the Quran says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا سَلَاسَا. Don't say Trinity. In fact, if you analyze, as I said in my talk, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, never spoke about Trinity. That Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, they were one. In fact, he said in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse number 28, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29, my Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28, I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20, with the finger of God I cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. Because I seek not my will, but the will of thy Father who has sent me. He never spoke about Trinity. In fact, when he was asked that which is the first of the commandments, he said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12, verse number 29, Shama Israelo adna ilahainu adna ikhaz, which means, Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God, is one Lord. But if you ask the Christian church, in the catechism, they tell you that the Father is a person, the Son is a person, and the Holy Ghost is a person. But they aren't three persons. They are one person. Person, 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 but not three person, one person. What language is this? 1 + 1 + 1 is equal to 3. It's not equal to 1. 1 × 3 is 3, not 1. So when we ask them that suppose there are 3 triplets, identical triplets, if one of them commits murder, can you hang the other? They say no. Then you ask them why? Because each one has a different personality. If one of the triplets commit murder, you can't hang the other because each one has a different personality. And when the Christian, when they think about the Father in heaven, they think like an old man like Santa Claus sitting in the heaven on one of the planets with the earth as a footstool. When they think about the Son, that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, they think of a tall man who is fair, who has got blonde eyes, like Jeffrey Hunter. You see in the movie King of Kings, he did the acting of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Jeffrey Hunter. They have a certain mental picture. When they talk about Holy Ghost, they think of a dove, as the Bible says, which came upon Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, when he was baptized. Or they think it like a spirit that came at the Feast of Pentecost, which is mentioned in the Bible. But when you ask the Christian that when you speak about Trinity, how many pictures do you have in your mind, the Christian will tell you one. Believe me, he's lying to you. Because 1 + 1 + 1 is 3, it is not 1. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muhammad Javed. And my question is, why can't God not take a human form?
The brother asked the question that why can God not take a human form? If God wants, he can take a human form. But the moment he takes a human form, he ceases to be God. Because God and man, they are two opposites. Man is mortal. God is immortal. You can't have a mortal and immortal person at the same time. Man has a beginning. God has got no beginning. You can't have a person who has a beginning and no beginning at the same time. Man has an end. God has no end. So you can't have a person having an end and no end at the same time. It doesn't make sense. So you can't have a God-man. You can either have God or you can have man. You can't have a God-man. So if God takes human form, he ceases to be God. He becomes human being. Because man requires to eat. God does not require to eat. The Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse number 14 that he feedeth everyone but doesn't require to be fed. The human beings, they require rest. They require sleep. The Quran says in Ayatul Kursi chapter number 2 verse number 255, which was also recited by the Qari, Brother Shaykh Muhammadi, Allahu la ilaha al-hayyul qayyum. لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم لو ما في السماوات وما في الأرض. Allah, he is one and only, the self-existing, the eternal. No slumber can seize him, nor does he require sleep. To him belongs everything in the heaven and the earth. Therefore, God, when he takes the human form, he ceases to be God. You can't have a God-man together. And if a God becomes human being and gives up his quality and becomes man, why should you worship a human being? Because he has same powers than you and me. People will want to worship you and me also then. What is the use of worshipping a person who has same powers like you and me? And later on, if someone tells me this same human being became God, it's not possible. If human beings can become God, even you and I would become God tomorrow. Therefore, if Allah wants, he can become a human being. But he will cease to be a God. Therefore, Allah will never want to become a human being. Allah can tell a lie if he wants. But he will never tell a lie. Because to lie is ungodly. The moment he lies, he ceases to be God. Allah can do injustice if he wants. But he will not. Because to do injustice is ungodly. As the Holy Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse number 40 that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. So if he does injustice, he ceases to be God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he wants, he can make a mistake. But he will not make a mistake, because to make mistake is ungodly. The Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse 52, that Allah does not make mistake. Allah doesn't err. So if he makes a mistake, he ceases to be God. Allah can forget if he wants, but he will not forget, because forgetting is an ungodly act. The Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse 52, Allah doesn't make a mistake, neither does he forget. The moment he forgets, he ceases to be God. Therefore, the Holy Quran says, Inna Allah ala kulli shayin qadir. Verily, Allah has power over all things. In several places, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 106, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 109, Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 284, Surah Al-Imran chapter number 3 verse 29, Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 77, in Surah Fatir chapter 35 verse number 1, Allah says, Inna Allah ala kulli shayin qadir. For verily, Allah has power over all things. But Allah only does godly things. He doesn't do ungodly things. Because Quran says in Surah Buruj, chapter 85, verse number 16, Allah is the doer of all he intends. Whatever Allah intends, he can do. But he only intends godly things. This theory of God becoming a human form is called as anthropomorphism. Almighty God taking a human form. And most of the major religions, sometime or the other, they have in their philosophy that God has taken a human form. Some religion once, some several times. And they have a very beautiful logic for that. They say that God Almighty, He is so pure, He is so holy. He doesn't know regarding the feelings of the human being, regarding the shortcomings, the difficulties a human being can have. He is so holy and pure. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know how does a human being feel when he's hurt. How does he feel when he gets into trouble? So therefore, God Almighty came in the form of a human being in this world to set the rules for the human being. On the face of it, very good logic. But I tell these people that if I manufacture a tape recorder, do I have to become a tape recorder to know what is good or what is bad for the tape recorder? No. I just write an instruction manual. When you want to play the audio cassette, put in the cassette, press the play button. When you want to stop, press the stop button. When you want to fast forward, press the FF button. Don't drop it from a height, it will get spoiled. Don't immerse it in water, it will get damaged. I write an instruction manual. I don't have to become a tape recorder to know what is good or what is bad for the tape recorder. Similarly, when Almighty God is our creator, He doesn't have to become a human being to know what is good or what is bad for the human being. He sends an instruction manual. And the last and final instruction manual for the human beings is the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran is the last and final instruction manual for the human beings, the do's and don'ts for the human beings. And He need not come down in this world as a human being to give us the instruction manual. What does He do? He chooses a man amongst men to deliver His message, whom we call as messengers or prophets, who He communicates on a higher level through the revelation. It is so clear-cut to any logical person that God Almighty cannot take human form. But any fool can also understand. That's the reason the Holy Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 18, Summum bukmun umyun faumla erjiyun. The deaf, the dumb, the blind, they will not come to the true path. And the Bible gives the same message in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 13, verse number 13. Seeing they see not, hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. Rig Veda also gives the same message in book number 10, chapter number 71, verse number 4, that though they see the word, they see it not. Though they hear the word, they hear not.
Next question from the ladies, sir.
Assalamu alaikum. If all the major religions and scriptures speak about one God, then does it imply that all these religious scriptures, that is Bible, Vedas, etc., are the word of God? And does it further imply that whichever religion you follow, be it Islam or Hinduism or Christianity, It is one, the same.
The sister asked the question that I have quoted so many various scriptures and proved about the concept of Almighty God, that is monotheism. Does it imply that all these religious scriptures I quoted, they are the word of Almighty God? And does it imply that irrespective whether you follow Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, it's one and the same? Sister, many people have the misconception that Islam came into existence and the founder of the religion of Islam was Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, 400 years ago. In fact, Islam is there in existence since time immemorial, since man set foot on the earth. And the Holy Quran says in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 24, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِهَا نَزِيرٍ. There is not a nation or a tribe to whom we have not sent a warner. The Holy Quran says in Surah Ra, chapter number 13, verse number 7, وَلِقُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. And to every nation have we sent a guide. By name, only 25 are mentioned in the Holy Quran. But our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, there were more than 124,000 messengers sent on the face of the earth. By name, we know only 25 mentioned in the Holy Quran. Adam, Moses, Jesus, Solomon, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. But there were more than 124,000 messengers sent on the face of the earth. Similarly, by name, we know only 4 revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God. The Torah, the Zabur, the Injil, and the Furqan. Torah is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Moses, peace be upon him. Zabur is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to David, peace be upon him. Injil is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Jesus, peace be upon him. And Furqan, that the Holy Quran, is the last and final revelation which was given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But if you analyze that all the other scriptures, whether are they the word of God or not, Bible, can I say it's the word of God or not? We believe in the Injil, the Wahi which was given to Isa alayhi salam. This Bible that the Christians have today is not the Wahi which we believe in. This Bible does contain the word of God. It also contains the word of prophet and also words of historian as well as pornography. It's totally not the word of God. No wonder the Christian scholars, they're keeping on revising the Bible. We believe in the original Wahi given to Isa alayhi salam, but the present Bible is not the correct Wahi. It may contain part of the Wahi. How to check up which part is true? You have to check it with the Furqan. And the Furqan is the Holy Quran. Similarly, if you analyze all the messengers that were sent before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, all the revelations that came before Holy Quran, all of these revelations and these messengers were only sent for their people. And the message was supposed to be followed only for a particular limited time period. As the Holy Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 49, that Isa alayhi salam, he was sent only for the Bani Israel. The message is repeated in Surah Saf chapter 61 verse number 6, that Isa alayhi salam, the son of Mary, was sent only for the Bani Israel, the children of Israel. The same message is given in the Bible, in the Gospel of Matthew chapter number 10 verse number 5 to 6. That Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, tells his disciples that go ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? The non-Jews, the Hindus, the Muslims. Go ye not into the way of the Gentiles, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That means he was only sent for the house of Israel. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 15, verse number 24, that I have not been sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So all the messengers and all the revelations, by name only 4 revelations are given in the Holy Quran. But there were several revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Sufa, Ibrahim, and various other revelations. But all the revelations that came before the Holy Quran and all the messengers that came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only sent for their people and for a particular time period. But our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the Holy Quran says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 107, it says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humankind, as a mercy to all the world, as a mercy to all the creatures. The Holy Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter 34, verse number 28, that وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا, that we have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the humankind yet do not know. Similarly, all the religious scriptures that were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that came before the Quran were only meant for that people and for a particular time period. But the Holy Quran, it says in Surah Ibrahim chapter 14 verse 52, as well as Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 185, and Surah Al-Zumur chapter 39 verse number 41, that it was sent for the whole of humanity. Regarding a question, that are these scriptures, the Vedas, the Bible, the Avesta, the Satir, the Upanishad, are they the word of Almighty God? What I can say, that we believe in Injil as the word of God, but the present Bible is not the word of God. Regarding Veda, Upanishad, Gita, Zed Avesta, Dasati, I can say maybe they were the word of God. Maybe. I cannot say for sure. Since the Quran does not say that Veda is the word of God, I cannot say for sure. I can only say maybe they were word of God. But even if they were the word of God, all the scriptures besides the Holy Quran have been changed by human beings. They have been corrupted. As a famous critic of Islam, William Muir, he said 2 centuries before that the only religious scriptures which has maintained its purity is the Holy Quran for 12 centuries. William Muir, who is a very strong critic of Islam, he had to agree that this Quran has maintained its original purity for 12 centuries. He said this 200 years before. So, regarding the messengers, whether Ram, whether Lakshman, all these, were they messengers of God or not? Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was, because the Quran says. But the name of Ram and Buddha and Zoroaster is not mentioned in the Quran. What I can say, maybe they were, I don't know. But even if they were only meant for that time. And they were only supposed to be followed by that particular people. The scriptures that came before the Quran, they were only meant for a particular group of people. And they were only meant to be followed till that time. So even if they were words of God, even if the previous messengers were messengers of God, you only have to follow the last and final messenger, that is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Even if the other scriptures were the word of God, today you have to follow the last and final message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the Holy Quran and nothing else. Regarding, can you be a Christian, Hindu, Muslim, it's the same? No, sister. It's not the same. Why? Because if you analyze, the Holy Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3, verse number 52, that Jesus, peace be upon him, he was a Muslim. Same thing as the Bible says in Gospel of John chapter 5, verse number 30. I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. If you translate into Arabic, not my will, God's will, it is nothing but Islam. He was a Muslim. Abraham, peace be upon him, the Holy Quran says in Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 67, he was not a Jew or a Christian, he was a Muslim. So today if you have to choose any religion, the Holy Quran says in Surah Imran chapter 3 verse number 19, inna deena indallahi al-islam, the only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. Though the other religions speak about monotheism, only monotheism is not sufficient. You have to believe in tawheed. You have to do the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Holy Quran repeats the message in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 85. That if anyone desires any other religion besides Islam, submitting the will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will not be accepted of him. And in the hereafter, he'll be among the losers. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Azam Khan and a mechanical engineer by profession. First, I congratulate you for the beautiful speech you have delivered. Now, my question is, water is called by different names in different languages. like in English as water, in Hindi as Pani, in Tamil as Tani. Similarly, if God is either called Ram or Jasar, is it not one and the same?
So that was the question, that water in different languages can be called as water in English, Pani in Hindi, Tani in Tamil. Similarly, God is one. Can we not call Him by Ram or Jesus, etc.? Peace be upon Him. As I mentioned in my talk, the Holy Quran says in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse number 110, Qulidullah Abidur Rahman, Ayyama Tadu, Falaul Asmaul Husna. Say, call upon Him by Allah or by Rahman. By whichever name you call upon Him, to Him belongs the most beautiful name. You can call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by any name, but it should be a beautiful name, and it should not conjure up a mental picture. It should contain the qualities of Almighty God. And the same message is repeated in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 8. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 180. As well as in Surah Al-Hashr, chapter 59, verse number 24, which says, to Allah belongs the most beautiful name. You can call Him by any name, but it should not conjure up a mental picture. Regarding a question that water is called by different names in different languages, and I know about it. In English it's called as water, in Hindi as Pani, in Tamil as Sunny, in Arabic it's called as Ma, in Surah Al-Anbiya chapter 21 verse number 30, in Sanskrit it's called as Apa, in Bhagavad Gita chapter number 7 verse number 4. In Shuddha Hindi it's called as Jal, in Gujarati as Jal or Pani, in Marathi as Pani, it's called as in Kannad, it's called as Nir, in Telugu, Nir, and Malayalam as Vellam, various languages. You can call. I gave you only 10 examples. Quran gives 99 attributes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there's no objection if you call water in any language, as long as it is water in any language. But it should be water. It should not be something else. For example, if suppose someone comes and tells me that I have been advised by my friend that every day in the morning I should have one glass of Pani. I know Pani means water, so I understand what he's saying. But then he continues, but when I have that one glass of Pani, I feel like vomiting. I ask him, why do you feel like vomiting? So he tells me, because the water stinks. It is yellowish in color. Later I realize that what he's talking is not Pani, it is urine. So somebody told him that you have one glass of urine, but the name he gave was Pani. So you can call water by Pani, Tani, Mani, Apa, Pani, no problem. But it should be water. You can call water by any name, but anything else besides water, neither can you call it water, neither can you call it Pani, neither can you call it Tani, neither can you call it as Mani. Water as water you can call, but something else as water you can't call. People may think that what? An illogical example. Even an ignorant person can make out the difference between urine and water. Only a fool will not know the difference between urine and water. And I agree with them, that even an ignorant person knows the difference between urine and water. Similarly, those people who know the concept of Almighty God, the correct concept, they say that these people who worship false gods, they are not only ignorant, they are foolish. Can't they differentiate between a true God and a false God? You give it any name. But if it's a true God, you can give it the name of God. If it's not a true God, you're giving false God the name of God. Aren't they foolish? They are foolish. For example, if you want to buy some gold, there's a person who comes and wants to sell his gold jewelry to you. And he says, this is 24 karat sona. You know that sona in Hindi means gold. In Arabic it is zahaba. You know it very well. But even after knowing that sona in Hindi is for gold, yet you will not just buy it like that. You will verify whether the sona, what is calling 24 karat sona, is it actually 24 karat gold or not. You will not just buy it off. What will you do? You will go to a goldsmith and verify whether it is actually 24 karat sona or not. and after verifying with the touchstone, you know, I give the example of touchstone in my talk, he tells you it is fake. Though the jewelry was glittering, but all that glitter is not gold. You will verify before buying the sona whether it's actually sona or not. Why? Because you have to pay money for it. You know, you don't want to lose. Because you know, if you lose 1,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees, it's precious. So why don't you do the same when anyone says this is God? You check it up with the touchstone. Which is the touchstone? Surah Ikhlas. Chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say he is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him. So anyone says this is God, you first check it up with the touchstone whether actually is God or not. If he fits in that definition, we have got no objection accepting that person who they are calling as Almighty God. For example, suppose some lunatic, he says that Muhammad, peace be upon him, he is Almighty God, a lunatic if he says that. We know we Muslims, we love our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We love him. We will do anything for him. We obey him. Even the non-Muslims. Mikaeel Eesa, when he wrote a book on 100 most influential people in the world, number one he gave to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Yet, in spite of that, we will use the touchstone, Surah Ikhlas. Though we respect him maximum amongst all the human beings, yet we'll check with the touchstone, Surah Ikhlas. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say is Allah one and only. Is Muhammad one and only? May peace be upon him. Allah has sent several messengers. He's not the only messenger. We agree he's the last and final. But Quran says you have to believe in all the messengers. Do not differentiate in the belief of the messengers. Second is Allahu Samad. Allah the absolute eternal. We know that our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was a great human being, but he was not absolute eternal. He toiled, he worked hard. His biography tells us that he was even stoned many times. He prayed to Almighty God. He was not absolute eternal. Third test is Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is begotten. We know that he was born in Mecca. He had a father and mother by the name of Abdullah and Amina. He had parents. He had children also. Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her. Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him. He had. He was begotten and he also begat. So he is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for sure. Though we Muslim, we love our Prophet. We respect our Prophet. No Muslim in his true senses will ever say that Prophet Muhammad is Almighty God. Never. You know why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has seen to it that the Islamic creed, the Shahada, says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. We say this 5 times a day minimum. In the Adhan, in the Iqama, before Salah, we always say there is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. He is the servant of Allah. To see to it that no one, however much he may love, he may not equate him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whoever you are saying is Almighty God, you use the touchstone. Whether it be Jesus, whether it be Ram, whether it be Krishna, whether it be Buddha, whether it be Mahavir, use the touchstone. I have given you the touchstone. On the day of judgment, I can give shahada to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the thousands of people that were present here, I showed them how to use the touchstone. Now the God that you worship, you apply this formula of touchstone to that God. If it passes the touchstone, even I agree he is Almighty God. If it doesn't pass, then you cannot call him God at all. Hope that answers the question.
My name is M.D. Marathe. I am a technologist. Before I start, I'd just like to explain that I would like to take the audience from the sentimental plane to a more scientific and rational plane. I hope I have your permission to that. Today's school books present the following information. In the course of evolution, the animal man or Homo erectus evolved 2 million years ago with a brain size of 1000 cc against a size of 400 cc of the apes. Evolution continued with the brain growing to 1400 cc 200,000 years ago, and this animal was known as Homo sapiens. The present form of man was evolved about 35,000 years ago and is known as Homo sapiens sapiens. Anthropologists have estimated that man developed a speech center in his brain 50,000 years ago. Now the question is, in this record of development, when did God originate and for what purpose? Number two, the progress of science has made it possible to...
Only one question, sir. Any question?
This is in relation to that. If you cut it short...
No,
the answer will not be long. Give me the time for the question. Please. Okay.
When
the progress of science has made it possible to clone all animals, including man, to produce any number of animals having all desired characteristics. If God ever existed, how much of the power attributed to God is now left with him? And the last, if God is ever existed, how much of the power attributed to God is now left with him? Third one, God is described as a sea of kindness, finished, and mercy. Yet all leaders of all religions, when faced with the prospect of death, rush to a hospital like the one next door, and never to the place of worship where they preached all their life that man lives and dies by the wish of God. Is there an explanation for this phenomenon?
The brother has asked basically three questions. First, he gave, according to him, the theory of evolution of man and said, where does God fit in? Secondly, after God has created all these things, how much of his power has been reduced? Thirdly, that when you get sick, you run to the hospital, not to the temple or church or masjid. Three part of the question. He said the answer will be short. The question was long. So imagine to give a detailed answer will take time. Brother, I'd like to tell you that what you quoted about the Homo sapiens, etc., you are talking about the theory of evolution, brother. Theory of evolution. I'm a medical doctor. I have not come across a single book in my life which says fact of evolution. It is theory of evolution. And even I know about the theory of evolution and about the Darwin's theory. Complete answer referred to my video cassette, Quran and Modern Science, Conflict of Conciliation. What Darwin said was only a theory. He wrote a letter to his friend Thomas Thornton in 1881 that I believe in this theory of natural selection because I don't have any proof. Only because it helps me in natural selection. It helps me in embryology, in classification, in rudimentary organs. There's no book saying the fact of evolution. All the books say theory of evolution. That's why if we have to say to a friend that if you are present at Darwin's time, Darwin's theory has been proved right, trying to insinuate you look like an ape. There were missing links. Darwin himself said the missing links. You spoke about the hominid, you only spoke about one wave. I'll tell you about all the four waves. The first wave was Lucy. Lucy was first wave which came 3.5 million years. You talk about 2 million years, I'm telling you what scientists have said 3 million years ago. Lucy. It died out by the ice age. The second came the Homo erectus. Homo erectus. About 500,000 years. After that came the Neanderthal man. The third wave. About 40,000 years ago. And the last was the Cro-Magnon. But brother, there's no link between all these stages. It's only a hypothesis. According to P.P. Grasset, who held the chair of evolutionary studies in Paris, in Sorbonne University, in 1971, he said, it is letting our imagination run too wild, just based on vestiges to say who our ancestors were. I do know there are some people who speak about Darwin's theory. I'm a medical doctor, I know about that. But do you know there are hundreds of scientists who speak against it? Few scientists speak in favor, but there are more who speak against it. For the complete answer, refer to my video called Quran Modern Science. There are few scientists, because there's no fact of evolution, they say let's support a theory. Quran doesn't support any theory or hypothesis. Quran speaks about fact. So regarding your 2 million years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no beginning. When man came, no one knows the exact date. No one knows. Assumption. Assumption is there. But Quran says the first man was Adam alayhi salam. First man. And with it came Eve. May Allah be pleased with her. Man hasn't reached that stage. There's not a single statement in the Holy Quran which science has proved wrong yet. Hypotheses go against the Quran. Theories go against the Quran. There's not a single scientific fact which is mentioned in the Holy Quran which goes against established science. It may go against theory. So brother, your thing is only supported by few people, not by the majority. Regarding second part of the question, that if Allah has created all these things, how less His power has become. You can't understand Him completely. As the Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 103, is beyond comprehension. I can give you a simile, not exactly same, an ocean. If you take a drop out of the ocean, how much does the level of the ocean go down? How much? How much? Yet, in spite of this, the difference between Allah becoming less when He creates things and the difference between the level of the ocean becoming less is infinite. The level of the ocean may become 0.00000 somewhere, 0.00 somewhere it will end. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not even a bit becomes less. He is all powerful. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If such a God who becomes less, we don't worship such God who becomes less. He keeps on creating, He will sometime lose His power. So this God is eternal, absolute. As I said in my talk, He is absolute and eternal. Everything depends on Him. He doesn't depend on anything. Where did Allah come? Allah was before the universe created. Where does He fit in? Where did He get created? He is uncreated. You ask me the question, where did He come into existence? He is uncreated. It's like you asking me that when I tell that my friend, he told me that my brother Tom, he gave birth to a child. Is the child girl or a boy? I, being a doctor, know very well a man cannot give birth to a child. So where does the question come, whether it's girl or a boy? So you are asking me, when did Allah come fit in the picture? Allah is uncreated. Because He is uncreated, the question doesn't arise. When did He come? He is there. Question doesn't arise. Regarding a third part of the question, that when people get sick, they run to the hospital. They don't run to the temple. They don't run to the mosque. Not to the church. The brother may not be knowing all the people. I am a doctor. I know that when the doctors give up, the thing we doctors say, we doctors say, "Huwa Shafi." It is He who cures. That doesn't mean that a person gets sick, only go to the temple. Because the Quran says in Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 43, as well as in Surah Furqan chapter 25 verse 59, if you are in doubt, go to a person who knows, who is an expert. If you get sick, besides praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, go to a person who is an expert in medicine, go to a doctor. Quran says that. But even after going to the doctor, have faith in Allah. Because He is the person who cures you. He can cure you with a doctor or without a doctor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we don't believe in blind belief. No Muslim scholar will ever say, if you are sick, don't go to a doctor. Go to a doctor, but finally, the person who cures is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why all the doctors, when all their brain, all their science, all the medicine fails, they say, it is only Allah who can save you.